some old songs tonight. Yeah, stand if you're able.
Thank you.
I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, a glorious day that will be. Sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, a glorious day that will be. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you, Lord, for your blessings of life, Lord. God, we just thank you for allowing us to be here tonight, Lord, and to worship you, Lord. And God, we just pray for all our sick, the ones that's on the prayer list, Lord. Just be with them, comfort them as only you can, Lord. And God, for our services tonight, Lord, I pray for the preaching, Lord, the singing, everything that we try to do, Lord. We want to give you the praise and honor and glory for everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. this next video is If I Got Jesus by Ben Fuller.
Take your Bibles and let's go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, we're going to look at verses 1 through 5 tonight, if I can make it through those five verses. There is just a rich depository of truth to be mined out of what Peter has written here in these opening verses. So stand with me, if you will. Let's read verses 1 through 5 of 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father and sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. You may be seated and join with me in prayer. Father, we commit this time to you, and Holy Spirit, we ask that you would just guide us, instruct us, teach us from your word. May we see the truth that you have given us. Your word is truth. And Lord, may we just dive into your word and saturate ourselves with your word and allow your word to saturate our minds, our thoughts, our desires, our intentions, our motives, our dreams, our aspirations, every part of our being. May your word rule supreme. Father, we submit ourselves unto you, and we ask for you to guide us in this time. And I ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Peter wrote this book. It is believed that he wrote it while he was in Rome, somewhere around AD 62 to AD 64, somewhere in that time period. Paul had been imprisoned in Rome, but it's not believed that Paul was there because Peter did not mention Paul being there in Rome. And it's believed that had Paul been in Rome, Peter probably would have mentioned it. He does mention Paul's writings about things being sometimes hard to understand. So he was familiar with Paul's letters that Paul had been sending to the various churches, Corinth, Ephesus, Colossians, Colossae, Galatia, Philippi, Thessalonica. So he was familiar with some of these things that Paul was writing. But Peter was an apostle. And the call of Peter, we find in John chapter 1, verses 35 through 42, where Andrew found Jesus. And then Andrew went and got his brother Peter and brought him back. And Jesus changed his name to Peter, which means stone. Cephas, and Peter was among the inner three of the apostles. Jesus called 12 to be apostles, and Peter was tended to be the chief of the apostles, if you will. He was, along with James and John, a part of that inner three that got to spend additional time with Jesus. They went up on the mountain when Jesus was transfigured before them. Oftentimes, Jesus would speak with them. John, the beloved apostle, we're looking at his gospel, on Sunday mornings. And James was the first apostle to be martyred. So these three men were very influential on the church, and the apostle Peter was very influential. Peter was called the apostle to the Jews. Paul was referred to as the apostle to the Gentiles. We find that in Galatians. He opens the letter and just says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, this letter that Peter wrote, it's a message of hope and encouragement in the midst of persecution, because throughout these five chapters, you'll find the theme of being persecuted for righteousness' sake, of being persecuted sometimes unfairly, sometimes being maligned, sometimes being spoken evil against. And we are to be found faithful in the midst of that. We are to be found faithful even when We are maligned by others, that others say that we are, they may call us arrogant, they may call us belligerent, they may call us intolerant, they'll call us any number of things. But listen, I want to just tell you something. We're going to be called a lot of things because we are living in wicked, demonic times. I mean, there is no doubt about that. We are living in a time where they want to promote that if a 12-year-old wants to change sex, that the school can withhold that information from parents. That's not true in Georgia, but it is true in some states. And in the state of Minnesota, from which the vice presidential nominee, along with Vice President Harris running for president, has signed into law that if the parents do not go along with the child's wishes, that the state can step in and remove that child from the home. They have made that a law in Minnesota. And listen, what 10, 11, 12-year-old knows what they want to be when they grow up? Levi is how old, 11? He doesn't know what he wants to be. I mean, he can talk about what he wants to be. And Haley can talk about what she wants to be when you grow up. I'm going to tell you something. Sid is 17, and she still don't know what she wants to do. Abby, you know what you want to do yet? Nope. And that's okay. So why would we allow a child to make a decision about having puberty blockers? I mean, we just live in times. And listen, when you make a stand against that, you can, and listen, it's going to come where we're going to have to stand. And we're going to have to speak truth to this. God made male and female, and God didn't make any mistakes. Now, regardless of how what may be going on in your family, what may be going on in the schools, what may be going on in society, God's word has not changed. And listen, they were facing persecution then. We're going to face persecution now. Rusty, y'all are going to Canada. What I just said would be classified as hate speech in Canada. Good luck. But they, you know, and Peter just says, listen, to make a stand, we don't have to be hateful. We don't have to be spiteful. We don't have to be loud and abusive, but we do need to speak the truth, and we need to speak the truth in love, and we need to realize that we're going to face persecution. Persecution has always been part of the church, and not only has persecution been part of the church, persecution's always been a part of those who follow the Lord. I mean, you go back into the Old Testament, the prophets were persecuted for proclaiming God's word. The people claimed to be God's people, the Jewish people, but yet they stoned the prophets, they rejected the prophets. You look at Daniel there in Babylon when they were in exile. Daniel was persecuted even there by unbelievers. Don't think we're any better than any of those. We're going to receive some of the same treatment. And some of the times, it not only will be from unbelievers, it'll be from so-called believers as well. I mean, it was the Jewish leaders that stoned Stephen. It was the Jewish leaders that sought to persecute the Apostle Paul, to have him arrested. He had one time been a persecutor himself. And Peter writes this letter just to a church that is in the midst of persecution. His church, he says, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Now, initially, when the church was birthed at Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came and the church was birthed, what did they do? They stayed right there in Jerusalem. They gathered, they had all things in common because they were being rejected by their Jewish brethren because they were following this man called Jesus who claimed to be the Messiah. And so they were making a stand to follow Christ, and they were paying a price to follow Christ, and so they were banding together. But what was the Great Commission? To go into all the world, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you, and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he said, lo, I'm with you always, but you to go. And he said in Acts 1:8, before he ascended, and you know, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, which was the region of which Jerusalem was a part of. So the city of Jerusalem, the region of Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth.
We're to go into all the world with the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And persecution is what dispersed the first disciples out of Jerusalem. They began to be persecuted, and so they left Jerusalem, going out to areas where they could worship and where they could, listen, nobody wants to be persecuted. I don't want to go to jail, particularly in the state of Georgia. The prison system in Georgia is horrendous. I just read an article about Valdosta State Prison, which is only an hour and 45 minutes away from here. They have less than 30% staffing. And a young man was just murdered there at Valdosta State. There's been four or five murders already this year. We just, I don't know why I mentioned that. I chased a rabbit and lost it. He darted left on me. Huh? Squirrel, yeah. It'll come to me in a minute. But anyways, so I don't want to go to prison. That's what it was. But it may be that happens one day. I mean, hate speech laws have been passed in Europe, have been passed in Canada, and this is in Western nations, where a woman was arrested in England because she was standing across the street from an abortion clinic, and she was praying in her mind, and when a British police officer, approached her and asked her what she was doing, she said, "I'm standing here." He said, "Are you praying?" She said, "In my mind." And they proceeded to arrest her. Like, they can tell you what you can think, what you can pray inside. I mean, that just to stand there and to silently pray is to be deemed illegal. I'm sorry, but that's what we're facing. And listen, if you don't think it will come here, you better think again. Because what is going on in the world is slowly making, I won't even say slowly, it's fastly making it, very, very rapidly making its way here. And we're going to face the decision, either we'll stand for Christ or we'll capitulate to the culture and just go along to get along. We can't do that. And Peter says, I want to encourage you. And so these believers, these early believers, they were scattered out because of persecution. Nobody wants to go to jail. Nobody wants to be persecuted. None of us seek it out. And listen, if you go out looking to be persecuted, if you do things in order to be persecuted, I'm talking about you intentionally. Now, I'm not talking about standing for the truth. I'm talking about there are sometimes we bring trouble on our own head. But Peter is writing to these that have been dispersed abroad, and he is the apostle to the Jews. Paul tells us that in Galatians 2, verses 7 and 8. Listen to what he says. He said, "But on the contrary, when they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised had been committed to me, as the gospel for the circumcised was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me towards the Gentiles." So Peter was the apostle to the Jews. Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles. And so Peter is writing to these Jewish believers, and also, quite likely, would have been some Gentile believers. And so his letter is a letter of encouragement and hope in the midst of persecution, but it's also a clarion call to holiness, to live a holy life. We'll see later in this chapter that he says in verse 16, "Be holy, for I am holy." We got a lot of people don't want to talk about holiness, but holiness is needed. For the writer in Hebrews tells us, "Without holiness, no one shall see the Lord." So, continuing on, he says here, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion." Now, when you use that word "pilgrims," the word literally means a sojourner, someone who is a temporary resident. Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, that our citizenship is in heaven, that we're not citizens of this. We talk about our citizenship, and listen, there's a lot of talk in regard to immigration and stuff, and I'll just go on the record. I'm for having a defined border. I find it interesting that these who say that we should have an open border policy, they don't hold that same truth over between Ukraine and Russia. They realize that Russia crossed the border into Ukraine, and that there is the worry that Russia, if they succeed in Ukraine, and I'm not advocating support for Ukraine or pulling, I'm just saying that there are borders there, and they're worried about that they may potentially seek to reunite Poland as a part of the Soviet Union. That is part of Putin's goal. There's borders. And yet there are those who say, well, just let them come on. But we realize, while we are citizens of the United States, citizenship should mean something. Paul tells us, really, in Philippians 3, verse 20, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So we sang tonight, this world's not... Did we sing that song tonight? Is that one of the ones we sang, This World's Not My Home? No. We sang, I enjoyed the songs tonight, too, by the way. And singing those songs. But we are pilgrims passing through. This world is not my home. And I'm grateful for that. The older I get, the more I long for heaven, because I'll be removed from sin's presence. You ever get tired of your struggles with temptations? I do. And you say, preacher, you have temptations? Absolutely. Same as you do. We all do. And we struggle with them. And sin. And being removed from sin's presence. And what sin has brought upon us, sickness and disease and death. Being removed from that. But he says to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father and sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, we may not make it through verse 5. Because right here, he says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. What Peter tells us is that we are selected by the Father, we are saved by the Son, and we are sanctified by the Holy Spirit. God has selected us. Let me read to you what Warren Wiersbe says. And if you haven't noticed by now, I really like Warren Wiersbe. There are other commentators out there, but Warren Wiersbe is one of my favorites because he puts the cookies down on the bottom shelf. It's easy to understand, to relate to. He says this about verse 3 of 1 Peter 1. He says, as far as God the Father is concerned, I was saved when he chose me in Christ before the foundation of the world. As far as the Son is concerned, I was saved when he died for me on the cross. But as far as the Spirit is concerned, I was saved when I first heard the gospel and received Christ. Then it all came together, but it took all three persons of the Godhead to bring me to salvation. If we separate these ministries, we will either deny divine sovereignty or human responsibility, and that would lead to heresy. Now, turn with me for a moment over here to Ephesians chapter 1 when it says elect according to the foreknowledge of God. There are people that are afraid of the word elect or predestined, or it's like the boogeyman or something. I want you to understand, there is no one who wants to be saved who cannot be saved, but it is clear teaching of Scripture that election, predestination, if you will, God's sovereignty, but is also taught man's responsibility and man's. But look what he says here in Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 14. I want you to listen to what God, who is doing the work, who is the object of what is being done here. It's being done for us, but it's being done by God. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world." God did not just decide to save you on the night in which you professed faith in Christ. He chose you before the foundation of the world, before you were ever conceived in your mother's womb, before you were ever thought of. God already knew you. He told Jeremiah, I called you to be a prophet before I formed you in your mother's womb. And if you have trouble with that, listen, you need to sit there and read what God says. This is what God says. And he said, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. It's not of anything we can do. He would go on and say in chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. The fact that you are saved is proof that the Holy Spirit has done a work of grace in your heart. He says, we have redemption through his blood that forgives us sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence. He made to abound. That's not just a little bit. You didn't get just a little bit of grace. He made his grace abound toward us. It overflows. His mercy overflows to us. He said, verse 9, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure which he proposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. That's what God has done for us. And so Peter says here that we are elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in sanctification of the Spirit. The work of the Holy Spirit in sanctifying us and setting us apart, making us distinct, that is a work of the Holy Spirit. And as Bill Stafford used to say, Jesus is in the business of knocking you out of you so that he can fill you with himself and live his life through you. And that's what the Holy Spirit is doing. Jesus said when he sends the Holy Spirit that he will testify of him, that he will glorify him. And so God wants us to be set apart. He wants us to be distinct. He doesn't want us to blend in with the culture. He doesn't want us to blend in with the world. He doesn't want us to look like the world. And too many churches today, Lucille was telling me about what Pat was talking about, the church down there, that too many churches today, we want to look like the world, we want to act like the world, we want to sound like the world, and we want to turn worship into an entertainment session. Worship is not about how we feel, it's about who we are, who is the object of our worship. If people go out, people leave church, say, well, I didn't get nothing out of that day. What'd you put in? It's just like your bank account. You can't get a dime out of it if you don't put a dime in. You better put something in if you want to get something out. People leave and say, well, I didn't get nothing out of it. The problem most likely is with what you put in. See, there's people trying to draw off stuff that they ain't put nothing in. You can't do it. And so he says, the work of sanctification of the Holy Spirit, he says, for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus loved you. People say, I don't believe God could love me. Listen, point them to the cross. Point them to the cross. Jesus went to the cross. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, tell them, God says whosoever believes. And you're one of those whosoever's. The problem is not with God, the problem is with you. God says, I love you. How much do I love you? I gave my Son to die for your sins, that you might have everlasting life, not temporary life. Man, what good news that is. Jesus shed his royal blood. As I told you before, Brother Earl Katoy, the pastor, just a country preacher over there in Tift County, When he prayed with my in-laws that day, when I was there, and he talked about, when he prayed, gave me, I still remember, he talked about that royal blood that was shed. Jesus, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, willingly laid down his life, allowed his blood to drain from his body. The Passover lamb for you and I. That's good news. And so we're set apart by the Spirit. We're selected by the Father. But we're saved by the Son. We're covered by the blood of Jesus. And while men may kill our bodies, they cannot kill our soul, our spirit. They can cut our heads off, rip our hearts out, burn us into ashes, but they cannot separate us from the love of Christ. They can't. Why? Because we are safe in Christ. That doesn't mean that we won't suffer harm. I mean, Peter was crucified. Paul was beheaded. James was killed by the sword by Herod. And you can read about how the apostles, many of them, except for the apostle John, and they tried to boil him in oil and then exiled him to Patmos. I can't imagine being boiled in oil. Believers, during this time in which Peter's writing, Nero began his persecution, and historians are divided on whether or not Nero actually set Rome ablaze. Many believe he did, but there's some that believe, through a set of other circumstances, the fire, whatever, Nero used the Christians to blame. And he would have them wrapped in animal skins so that the dogs, and they'd put them out, they'd wrap them in animal skins, skin animals, wrap them in that and put them out to the wild beast, be ravaged by a wild beast. He would put them in the arena, in the Colosseum, as sport, and turn the wild beast loose on them, would cover them in tar and set them aflame, a fire, to be used as torches. Believers may suffer harm, but they will not suffer loss because of Christ. And that's what Jesus has done for us. We are covered by him and we are kept by him. And that's what he goes on to say here. He says, grace to you and peace be multiplied. I love that when he says, peace be multiplied. Now, if he just said, grace to you and peace be added, that's good. But when he says, and peace be multiplied, if I can tell you I can add your money for you or I can multiply your money for you, which would you rather have? Now, Sid will watch the stream, so if you're watching this, I'm going to ask you about that one. Would you rather it be added or multiplied? I'd rather it be multiplied. And then he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy. I can tell I ain't going to get through verse 5 tonight. He says, according to his abundant mercy. If he had just said, according to his mercy. But I want you to notice the adjectives that Scripture uses. When you're reading Scripture, look at these adjectives and adverbs that add to. I mean, Paul in Ephesians 3:20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. I mean, if he just said, now to him who is able to do exceedingly above all that we ask, exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Here he says, according to his abundant mercy. I want to tell you something. You cannot outrun God's mercy. You cannot outsin God's mercy. Now listen, if you're a child of God, you should not want to try to outsin
God's mercy. Again, we're not sinless, but we ought to sin less. We ought to have a desire for holy living, and we all fall short. But his abundant mercy, Psalm 136, you can read that. I'm not going to read that for you tonight, but you can read that his mercy endures forever. There is not going to be a day where you get an overdraft notice from the bank on God's mercy. You're not going to, sorry, you used up your allotment. He allotted so much mercy to you, and you have exceeded it. You have overdrawn the account. It's not going to happen. God's mercy is abundant. His grace is abundant. When you were not seeking him, he was seeking you. He could have left you completely alone. Listen, if God lets you go to hell, he'd be completely just. But yeah, he set his love on you. We like to talk about he set his love on us. No, he set his love on me. Think individually. Don't just think, yes, think corporately. He set his love on us, on the church, but he also set his love on me. Because there are people who think, oh, God can't, I just struggle with this. Can God love me? Yes. Why? Because of the blood of Christ. Because according to his abundant mercy, his mercy is inexhaustible. God is not just a God of a second chance. He's a God of another chance. But don't presume on the next chance. There's too many people presuming upon the next chance. Well, I'll have another chance. I'm going to go out and do what I want to right now and live how I want to. And once I've gone and I've had my fun, then I'm going to come. You're presuming upon a chance you may not get. Yes, he's a God of another chance. And yes, we've all messed up. And we've all strayed off. We've all wandered off. And people, we come in church and we act like, not anybody here. Oh, yeah, we all have. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. We all do that. But he is a God of another chance. And you'll find that if you'll turn towards home, the Father is always waiting. He's never got his hand up saying, oop, stop. You ain't paid enough. You want to know why? Because if you're his child, Jesus has already paid your price. He says, come home, my child, come home. We used to sing that song, Ray of the Invitation. Come home. I can't remember all of it, but come home. Yeah, I'm not going to try to sing it. I have an amplification, and that's not necessary with my singing. When it comes to my singing, I need that Barney mic. And if you've watched Andy Griffiths, you'll know what I'm talking about. But that's what he has done for us. He says, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope. We have been born again. In Ephesians 2:1, Paul says, in you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. You were dead. I was dead spiritually, separated from God. And just like he went to the tomb of Lazarus and said, Lazarus, come forth, he called you by name. Oh, you might not have heard an audible name. But there was a time when you realized you were a sinner. And listen, I'm going to tell you something. We've got many in our churches today, I believe, that are lost. Why? Because they grew up in church. And they were told, all you need to do is you need to go forward during the invitation, take the preacher by the hand and fill out a 3x5 card, and you'll go through the baptism pool, and you're now part of the family of God. And they've never repented of sin. I'm not telling you children can't be saved. I believe they can. But I believe they need to have an awareness of sin and that they are a sinner. Otherwise, what are you being saved from, and what are you being saved to? And so there are people that have put their assurances in church membership. Well, I've been a member down there for 50 years. I'm telling you something, there'll be a lot of church members in hell. Because salvation is in Christ alone. It's not in the church membership. But he has begotten us. We have been born again, he says, to a living hope, not a dead hope. It's a living hope
through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Because Jesus is alive, we have hope. Our hope is, we talk about, I hope gas prices come down. I hope food prices come down. I hope the economy gets better. I hope interest rates come down. But that ain't nothing that you can count on. When I say my hope is built on Jesus Christ and his righteousness, my hope is on the solid rock of Christ. I have a hope that is sure, that is rock solid, that is steady, that I can cling to in the midst of a storm, that Jesus is my hope, that Jesus will deliver me, that Jesus will carry me home, that Jesus will see me through. That is my hope. It is a living hope, and it's based on the resurrection of Jesus Christ from death. If Jesus was still in the tomb, or if the apostles stole his body, then we got a dead hope. We don't have a dead hope. We have a living hope. And we who were dead ought to live and act like one who has been brought back to life. Instead, too many act like they are the living dead, just walking through. Well, I guess we get up and go to church today. Man, it sure does look good out there today. I bet the fish are biting. Oh, it'd be a good day to be on the golf course. Oh, it'd be a good day to sleep in. I'm tired. Church ought to be the reason for not doing some of those other things. Instead of those other things being the reason you don't make it to church. And I realize I'm preaching to the choir right now. You're here. But there are some people who do listen. When Jeremy puts up a stream, I guess, don't you, Jeremy? You put this up on the internet? Hello, everyone. There are some that watch it. Sid will watch it. I don't know if anybody else does. That's the only one I know of. I'm going to tell you, church ought to be the reason we miss everything else. I get to go to church. I get to worship with other believers. I get to be a part of the family of God. What a privilege that is. That all changed the mindset. And we got too many. Church is drudgery. And I realize church can be dry and our singing can be bland and blah, blah, blah. And we ought to be some of the most joyful people. Why? Because we got Jesus. We got the Holy Spirit in us. He says, he has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from death. I read from 1 Corinthians 15 this morning. Go read 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 20. Man, the resurrection. He says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. To an inheritance. Ephesians 1, Paul says there, verses 11, he says, in him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him. He works all things according to the counsel of his will. He says in verse 18, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. He says, verse 14, who is a guarantee of our inheritance? He's given us the Holy Spirit as a guarantee. We have an inheritance. See, I don't know what, I mean, I only have one parent left, my mother. And over the past 7 or 8 years, from a IRA disbursement, she had given me and my sister money. The only thing I know that when my mother died, she told me that she had a $50,000 life insurance policy, one for me and one for my sister. Beyond that, I don't know, but my sister has indicated to me that our mother is well taken care of where she's at. She doesn't have to worry about it. My stepfather took good care of her. I don't know the details. I don't know if I'll get anything, and it doesn't make any difference because I can't take none of it with me. I've got an inheritance far better than anything my parents could leave me. I've got an inheritance in heaven. Then look what he says here, incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away. Jesus said in Matthew 6, 19 through 21, to not lay up treasures here on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy nor thieves break in and steal. For where your heart, where your treasure is, there your heart, or where your heart is, where your treasure is, there your heart. Yeah, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Romans 8, 16 through 17, verses 16 and 17 talks about our inheritance that we have. He says it does not fade away, it's reserved in heaven. You ever called, made a reservation? You ever gone, shown up, and they said, we don't have any record of your reservation. I always print out a copy of my reservation. They send you a confirmation, print it out, screenshot it, save it. Say, there's my confirmation number right there. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. Jesus has given us, he has reserved for us an inheritance. And I don't have to show a confirmation number. All I got to do is look to Jesus. I'm going to stop right there. We'll pick back up in that next week. My breath is about giving out on me. I'm going to tell you something. I believe our study through 1 Peter is going to be good. You're going to want to be here. Not because of what I got to say, but what Peter contains for us. All right, let's stand and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for what you have promised us in your word. Thank you for the inheritance that is reserved for us. But Lord, that inheritance is only possible because we have been saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I agree with what Charles Spurgeon said one time. I believe that you chose me before the foundation of the world. Because had you waited until I had been born, I'm just as certain you never would have chosen me. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for your love. And Lord, may we be encouraged. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.